In the first example, we saw a two-factor ANOVA where both of the factors were fixed or controlled by the experimenter. We're going to look at one example of a random effect included in an ANOVA. This is specifically an experimental design feature called blocking that is fairly commonly used. In contrast to a fixed effect, a random effect is one that's not controlled by the experimenter. So it is a factor that we think might be important, but we don't have any way to actually control what its state is. In the experiment that we are working on, each individual cockroach and the implantation of the electrode, the distance of the LED from their eye, all of these are likely to randomly vary from each other in a way that we cannot control. And so some of the variants that we're seeing in the results are due to the differences among the different cockroaches, the implantations, and their LEDs. And this is a random variation, but it still is probably an important source of variation. Other examples that are common in experimental science would be differences among participants in an experiment, differences in an experimental site, perhaps caused by soil or slope or factors like that, or the day on which an experiment was conducted. One day may have different air pressure or light intensity or other sorts of things that are likely to affect our experiment, but that which we cannot control. One of the ways for dealing with this source of uncontrollable variation is to create an experimental unit called a block. A block is basically a blocked off area or a blocked off compartment, and each of the fixed effects is tried on that particular experimental unit. In the example of the cockroach experiment, each cockroach eye had every color of light applied to it. So the cockroach and its situation essentially was a block, and the fixed effect that we applied to that block was each of the three colors. The reason why we want to include random effects in an ANOVA is partially to be able to assess their influence. It's actually possible to determine what percentage of the variance is caused by random effects. The other thing which should not be overlooked is the fact that when you include a block or another random effect within the experimental design, we are able to pull some of the variability out of the residuals and to partition it out into the random effect. And as you recall, the variability of the residuals was on the denominator of F. So if we are able to remove some of the variability from the residuals, then the denominator will get smaller, F will get bigger, and that essentially increases the power of our experiment. If you think about it in terms of like the residuals being like fog, we're able to remove some of the fog from the situation and make the thing that we're trying to look at more clear. The statistics that are derived for random effects are calculated in a different way from fixed effects. So when we go to set up the ANOVA, we cannot simply use the same function with the same arguments as we did on a two-factor ANOVA where both of the effects were fixed. And we'll see how that is set up when we look at the example.